Welcome to an Around the Dog World with a Difference. It's an episode of Two Halves with our sights firmly set on hounds and gundogs. On a jam-packed weekend for dog shows, where two group and one all-breed best in show will be handed out, we're going to try and squeeze as much of this weekend's action into the next hour as possible. We start here at Hound Association in Stafford, with the second half coming from here in Malvern to capture everything gundog in the Three Counties Showground. Well, Di, we're here at the Hound Show, and we know you love the single-breed shows.
I do.
But we'll come back to it in just a minute. First of all, let's go back to east of England.
Yes.
Where Newfoundland champion Sand Bears Better Than Ever
looking
added a first best in show after his first group win.
Yeah, looked great. But we've liked the dog and really did everything was asked for.
And then came National Working and Pastoral Breeds, yes, where a more familiar face, yes, Hector the Bouvier, won the dual group best in show.
And Hector is a great example of watching a dog mature on. That dog gets better every time I see him.
And then back to the all breeds. Leeds was the following week.
Yeah, wonderful show.
Current top dog, Tyler the Bulldog, adds another best in show to his CV.
Yeah, looked terrific. And very interestingly, there was a Bulldog Club show in the next ring, a championship show. So all the Bulldoggers had chance to go twice. It was great.
Yeah, and we're here, Hound Association. Yeah. You love it when you come to these single groups.
I do. It's a chance for us to concentrate on specific groups. And all the groups are different. You know, we love the glamour of the toys, but the hounds are a very special group of dogs. They're athletic. They like to be out and about. They're working dogs. And through the sizes, but with them all, there's just that element of something mystical, especially the eastern ones. I mean, Afghans and Salukis with that faraway look. And there's something special about hounds.
And we'll come back to Afghans in particular in a moment, but the Hound Show this year have been innovative, haven't they?
Terrific. Fully compliment them on, it's a brave step, and it costs money to have judges from all over the world, 18 different countries, including America. And they may not do it again for several years, but it's an opportunity for you to get the opinions of judges that are breed specialists and have come here to this hound show. I think it's a great idea. Whatever's happening at dog shows, we have to be prepared to enjoy it, to embrace it. And if it's something different, it's only one show. Relax and enjoy it.
Well, thank you very much, Di. We'll speak to you later once all the breeds have been into the best in show ring. We are, of course, here at the Hound Show to focus on best in show, but if we're lucky, we'll take a glance at best puppy and best veteran too. And we'll do it later for the gundogs as well. Now, at Hound Show, we feel we must give a bit more attention to a few breeds in the group. Later on, we'll have a look at a breed close to the best in show judge, Bo Bengtson's heart. But first, the show-off in the hound group. We stopped off at Saxon Mill with Roberta Hall to learn more about the Afghan. Well, Roberta, Afghans have been a lifelong passion for you, but why Afghans?
Well, gosh. Well, it started really in 1964 when I was a very young girl, long, long time ago, a whole lifetime ago. Bored in school holidays, what was I going to do? So I walked up to the local pub where they were boarding kennels and asked if I could give a hand. And she also had an Afghan hound, a self-mast gold, the most beautiful creature I'd ever seen. So elegant, so aristocratic. She just completely captivated me, and I decided this is the breed for me. I could just imagine myself with Afghan hounds forever.
And you've used a few words to describe their temperaments, but elaborate a bit on that.
Okay, what is an Afghan like? Well, if you ask my husband, he would say they're like cats. They like to know what you're doing, but it's very much on their terms, and then they might go away and sleep. They won't follow you all around the house. But they're free spirits, they're sight hounds. So you can be out walking with them, have them loose in a park, and you think you've got their attention, but if they see something in the distance, they can go, and boy can they go. And there's nothing more fantastic than seeing an Afghan in full flight, going after small prey, which is what they were bred for in Afghanistan, where they were hunting dogs. There were two types. There were those in the mountains, which were much more heavily coated, and those on the plains, which look more Saluki-like. The Afghans we have here today are a combination of those two. The first Afghan that came into this country was Zardin, and he came in the early 1900s. But it's Zardin that the Kennel Club used to form the standard. Right. And that standard was put in place in 1946, and it's really much the same. But the difference in the dogs, if you look at pictures from years ago, and particularly the picture of Zardin, and you look at dogs of today, have they changed? And a lot would say, yes, they have. However, I think what's particularly changed is how we present the dog, because we didn't have the grooming products to do it. But the Afghan has five distinct breed characteristics that sets it apart from all other breeds. Far Eastern expression. They should have the expression that could actually freeze you, as if it says, don't you dare look at me, I can see through you and far beyond. They should have a natural saddle, which is the short hair on the back. They should have a ring tail, prominent hip bones, which is quite different to other breeds and other sight hounds. And most importantly, it's the smooth springy gait. It's like having a bird on a wire. You can feel it when you're moving your dogs around if you have one with this lovely, elegant, effortless spring, because you don't feel as though you've got them on the lead. It's just as though you're moving around and they're with you. And obviously they need all the other aspects that makes a good sight hound, a good deep chest, a level top line, good lay of shoulder, good return of upper arm, complementary hind angulation, short hocks.
And for the same reason they appeal now, must be why they became popular in the first place. Visually, they are spectacular.
Well, they are spectacular. I would say they're high maintenance. When I came into the breed in the 60s and 70s, they became very popular, and it was very much the dog to have in a lot of the TV adverts. But of course, with the explosion came along the problems associated. You know, it was something that I don't think any of us would want to go back to. Mm. A lot do go as pets, but generally to people, I would say, that have had them before or had experience of them before, because they are hard work, they're not particularly obedient. You can never quite be sure whether they would come back. Well, they'll come back, but it will be in their own time, you know, when they're ready. But they're a hound, they need to be fit, they need to be exercised. They need that for their mental state as well as their physical well-being. My dogs go out in the rain, they run free. But I do look after the coat. But hey, if you love the Afghan hound, that's part of it.
Well, hopefully you feel a bit more enlightened on the Afghan hound, but it's now time for Best in Show. I'll hand over to tonight's judge, Bo Bengtson.
And the Hound Association today are highly delighted to be able to have Mr. Bengtson to judge his first UK group. First up to be examined is the Afghan Hound, judged today by Roberta Poser. On the table now we have the Bezenji, judged by Leela Karkas. That's your Best of Breed Bezenji, Exhibit 173. That's your Best of Breed Bassifol de Pratan, Exhibit 230. Being examined now is the Bassy Griffin von Dean Grand, judged today by Jose Homen del Melio, Exhibit 275. Now we have the Bassy Griffin von Dean Petit, Exhibit 295. Being examined now is the Basset Hound, Best of Breed was the Bitch, today judged by Carla Gerber. On the table now we have the Beagle, judged by Mr. Frank Borg from Malta, 451. Being examined now is the Bloodhound, judged today by Jan Kopens from the Netherlands, Borzoi, and judged today by Irina Koshanova from Russia, Exhibit 581. On the table now we have the Cheneco del Etna, Exhibit 631. On the table now we have the long-haired Dachshund, judged today by Leslie Patton from Ireland. On the table now we have the miniature long-haired Dachshund, Best of Breed, Exhibit 774. The smooth-haired Dachshund, judged today by Per Iverson from Norway, Exhibit 875. On the table now we have the miniature smooth-haired Dachshund, That's your best of breed 910. We have the Wirehaired Dachshund, judged today by Bertie Skeel from Denmark. Best of breed 1030. We have the Miniature Wirehaired Dachshund, judged today by Jose Homen del Melio. Being examined now is the Deerhound, exhibit 1185. Being examined now is the Finnish Spitz, exhibit 1218. Next up now we have the Foxhound, judged today by Stephen Seymour. That's your best of breed Foxhound. Next up is the Greyhound, judged today by Mr. Per Iverson. Exhibit 1270. Next up to be examined is the Hamilton Stavare, exhibit 1288. Next up we have the Ibethan Hound, judged today by Gabriel Schroeder from Germany, exhibit 1306. Being examined now is the Irish Wolfhound, judged today by Sorka Wild. That's your best of breed. Being examined now is the Norwegian Helphound, exhibit 1427. Next up is the Faroe Hound, judged today by Gabriel Schroeter. That's your best of breed Faroe Hound. On the table now we have the Portuguese Podengo. That's your best of breed, exhibit 1499. Judged today by Jan Kopens from the Netherlands. That's your best of breed, exhibit 1572. Judged today by Francis Broadway from the USA. That's your best of breed, Saluki. That's your best of breed, Sluggy, exhibit 1694. That is your best of breed Whippet 1848.
Well, that's the last of Bo's best of breeds, so come back after the break to hear from our best in show judge about a breed he's recognised for around the world, the Whippet. Bo, you've got quite a day ahead of you. Must be quite special.
Very special indeed. I mean, these assignments don't come along a lot. I don't judge very much these days, but when you get asked to judge the Hound Association in England, you accept.
We're talking today about a breed that's very close to your heart.
Yes.
What about the history of the breed? They bear quite a great resemblance to the greyhound. Is there a link between the breeds?
Well, there have been greyhound whippet-like sighthounds for thousands of years. The Romans had dogs that looked very much like they do today. They were used for hunting hares. In fact, in New York, I saw a museum there, an old bronze that's from BC, and it's fantastic. It could be step out of a show ring today. Of course, we don't know what size it was. If it was a greyhound or a whippet. The truth probably was that there always were dogs that were of different sizes, and they were developed from them. Crossed with a little bit of terrier, maybe a little bit of Italian greyhound, and didn't start calling them whippets until they came to England, and the British really made it into a consistent, homogenous breed in the late 1800s.
And there's something quite special seeing a whippet at full pace, isn't
it? Yeah, being a whippet owner and having had them for more than 50 years, I kind of take it for granted, but I'm reminded every time I have some friend or neighbor or something see my dogs. I mean, the dogs lope around and everything, they think it's very pretty, and then for whatever reason they take off and it's more like a rocket, and people get really impressed. They are very, very fast. They did double suspension gallop. All the sighthounds do it to a certain degree, but the whippets being so small and you can see everything so clearly because of the thin coat, they are built for speed and they must be allowed to run. Now, if you don't want to let them run, you probably shouldn't have whippets.
But away from the original purpose of running and hunting, what are they like at home as pets?
The ideal pet, I think, for me, obviously. I've often thought I should, broaden. I've had other breeds, but whippets suit me really well. They're wonderful. If they get, 15 minutes of serious running and maybe a half an hour walk, they are happy to be on the couch all day and just, couldn't be sweeter, couldn't be easier. The ideal whippet temperament is very relaxed, civilized, sophisticated, easy to get along with, very affectionate.
And what about the standard? What is the ideal whippet?
The ideal whippet, I think the difficulty in the breed is to combine the maximum amount of power with a maximum amount of elegance. And that's not easy to find the right balance. It's very easy to get a lot of elegance, very easy to get a lot of power, but getting the two in the same dog at the same time, that's not easy.
And it is a British breed, mm-hmm. but across the world, where do you see the highest quality and the highest quantity?
It depends on which standards you go by, unfortunately, because for whatever reason, the standards are developed differently in different parts of the world. The American Whippet Club was more or less owned by two crusty old women in the 1920s, 30s, and they simply felt they should change the standard to suit their own dogs, so they did. As a result, the American side is a little more generous on size, they tend to be bigger. The American standard also emphasizes the glamour points a lot more, which is, to my mind, is rather unfortunate, because unless you have the correct body construction with a deep chest and good legs and bone and angulation, you don't really have a Whippet. And I think the best dogs in America, the best dogs in England, fit any standard.
And in the show ring, there's quite a variety of colour. Does the standard mention anything about
colour? No, that's a very important point, that you in Great Britain and Europe are far better at listening to than the judges in America, many of the judges in America, I should say, and you should never ever penalize a Whippet for colour.
Any advice for people looking for Whippets?
Yes, I think you have to remember one very important thing, is that having a Whippet puppy for the first year, it would be more or less like having a squirrel loose in your house. And people often don't quite believe that such a little meek and mild animal can be as... They climb the walls, they steal anything, they chew anything, they can do an amazing amount of destruction. But if you have patience and if you are firm and teach the dog what's what, by the time it's adult, you will have a wonderful, easy companion for life.
For further consideration in comes the Basset Griffon Von Dean Grand and Petit. Cinello de Etna, a wirehaired dachshund, a greyhound, an Irish wolfhound, sorry I missed out the smooth-haired dachshund, and the Whippet, and the Abethan hound. Finish with the rest, thank you very well getting this far, congratulations. All these exhibits are going to get a final runoff before the selection, show them your sport. Shortlist, ladies and gents. In comes the Grand Basset, the Wirehaired Dachshund, the Greyhound, and the Whippet. And many congratulations to the rest of the best of breeds. So we have our final four. Be ready for the boards. We're about to find out who was best in short. The Houndshow 2016. And the winner is the Whippet. And the runner-up is the Basset Grand. Third is the Greyhound. And fourth is the Wirehaired Dachshund. Congratulations to everybody.
Well, Charlie, that must be an incredible win.
I can't believe it. I'm still in shock now. You judged the Whippet Club in the UK a few months ago, and we didn't go under him because we're at the Contest of Champions. So to come under him now and to win that is just amazing. So nice.
And I spoke to you earlier in the day. Hazel's been in a bit of a dry spell.
Yeah, we went a few weeks. We got stuck on the unlucky 13 ticket. Yeah. So today was our 14th and what a way to get back on the roll.
What do you think she's going to do for the rest of the year? Do you think you can keep that roll going now?
I'd love to keep it going because, you know what, she deserves it. She's just perfect in every way.
Do you have to do anything to get that showmanship out of her?
Just have a pocket full of sausages and that's about it.
Well, congratulations again. Hopefully we see you throughout the rest of the year.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, Bo, your Best in Show winner here at the Hound Show was Hazel the Whippet. What did you make of her?
Oh, I didn't know her name was Hazel. I knew who she was. I had watched a video from Crafts and I liked her very much. It would be very interesting to see what an American all-rounder would make of her. I don't think we've had a fawn top-winning Whippet in America for the last 50 years or something. It shouldn't matter. She's very feminine, she's very classical. She's not quite the type I've had myself. I usually had the more bulky, maybe, perhaps. But she's very, very elegant. I liked her a lot.
And the Grand in second?
The Grand was just, I think, was so charming. It says that she should have lots of carriage and be noble and very well proportioned and beautifully handled.
And then we move on to your puppies. Your winner there, the Irish Wolfhound.
Mm-hmm. The same exhibitor had a very nice adult Wolfhound that made a cut. And I thought the puppy was even nicer, very sound, with a very beautiful type too, very nice mover.
You spoke about a rare colour in the Whippets, but an even rarer colour perhaps in the Dachshunds, the Mini Smooth, your reserve best puppy.
Yes, and also had a wonderful temperament, and it says courageous to the point of rashness in the standard, and that really fit that dog. I thought he was a wonderful little fella.
And was it right this was your first hound group in the UK?
The first hound group in the UK, yes. We have hound shows in the US, and they're very nice, but they have less than half the size of this. And then I've judged the breed, my favorite breed, Whippets, a few years ago. And to be able to judge Best in Show, and I was very flattered, and I had a great time.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us earlier on today and tonight. Congratulations again.
Thank you very much.
Well, there we are. We've had Best in Show, Best Puppy, and Best Veteran. And we're here with Di Johnson, Di Hazel the Whippet, Best in Show at the Hound Show.
We loved her. Well, we loved her at Crafts. Yeah. She's just a lovely quality Whippet. The short list of eight was, in my opinion, and in other top judges' opinion, absolutely spot on. And the four were lovely. Yeah. Yeah, there's no arguing with this man on hounds, I'm sure.
And he was quite excited just to be here earlier on today. He didn't want to miss any CCs being given out.
Yes, I'm sure it was exciting for him. And you were interested in what he thought, what was going on in his mind. I should be interested in talking to him later.
And then we move on to Boo's best puppy. Yes. A much bigger breed, the Irish Wolfhound.
Yeah, I thought the Irish Wolfhound in the group was lovely. It was shortlisted, wasn't it? But I thought they were both very good.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us, Di. We're not going to see you at Malvern tomorrow?
Afraid not. I'm not a gun. How dare I talk about gun dogs? You'll find somebody who really understands gun dogs.
Well, thank you very much. We'll speak to you again soon, no doubt. We'll see you again after the break and down the M5 at Malvern for National Gundog. Welcome back to Around the Dog World. Now, earlier on, we watched the conclusion of Hound Association in Stafford, but we're now here in Malvern to capture everything Gundog in the Three Counties Showground. Now, the UK might have voted out of the EU, but that's exactly where we're heading to spotlight a couple of Gundog breeds today. The first of which, a versatile Italian with spectacular movement. We want to find out a little more about the Bracco Italiano, with the only person to handle one to a couple of group wins, Nicola Maddox. Well, Nicola, what a past couple of months you've had.
Absolutely phenomenal. Can't believe it.
Now, it's not a breed many people in the UK will have heard of, but how far back do you think it can be traced?
Yeah, I mean, Bracco's a very ancient breed of Italian gun dog. I mean, there are writings back to the 5th and 6th century, and they've been a distinct breed in Italy since the Middle Ages. They were very prized by the Italian nobility, and families such as the Medici bred them. And they were originally bred in two specific parts of Italy, the Lombardy and Piedmont regions, and that gave rise to two different types of Bracco Italiano. There was a lighter, racier type, which were generally orange and white. They were from the Piedmont regions of Italy, where it was sort of more mountainous and hilly, and the heavier chestnut type of dog was bred in the Lombardy regions, which suited the flatter open fields. Mm. It's widely believed that the Egyptian hound and the Persian mastiff were instrumental in making the breed, yeah.
Yeah.
They petty. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, petty. Petty. Yeah, petty. Sorry. Ool. Ool.
That was the sister.
My bad, petty.
You've got them to come back there, but
You've had to learn a few words to...
I've had to learn a few Hungarian and Italian words. He's a bit multilingual as the dog.
So what was it in those early days of the breed it was designed and bred for?
They were originally bred to drive birds into nets, but obviously, them being an ancient dog, with the invention of the gun, the hunting style was adapted slightly.
And to modern days, how have they come to these shores?
No, they haven't been here at all. It was 1988, a couple called Liz and Jonathan Shaw, Scentling Kennels, they went over to Italy to watch Spinoni at a field trial.
Right.
And obviously they made a huge impression on the couple. Yeah. And in 1989, the first dog arrived in quarantine. His name was Zerbo. Over the recent years, with obviously the pet passport scheme coming in, there's been quite a boom and there's quite a few people that have imported them in now from Europe and around the world.
And you said they made such an impression. At Windsor, you said to us that he moves better when he's got
birds.
Yeah.
I can try and run as fast as I can in a ring round here, and he's not even out of first gear. He's just like whistling at the side, and he's like, come on, mother. I mean, the movement's described as almost elastic. It should be free flowing. It should be completely effortless. And like I say, they can keep that up for hours and hours in the field. I mean, I can stand there and watch him for just 20 minutes, just watching him move. I'll never, ever get tired of watching him move. He's fantastic, but, there's no way my little legs can carry me fast enough.
And take us over the rest of the appearance. What is it the standard says to expect?
The standard says that they should be a strong, well-balanced, powerful, well-muscled hunting dog, quite noble appearance. They should be almost square in outline with a very deep chest. The head is obviously a distinctive part of the breed. It should be very sculpted, the chiseling under the eyes, divergent planes of the head, that's extremely important. The head should be long and quite narrow, with lean cheeks. If you look at it from the front, the sides of the muzzle sort of converge slightly. And in profile, they should be sort of Roman-nosed. What you should be looking at, basically, is a working dog. I understand that not a lot of people have the opportunity to work the dogs, and they may not wish to do so, but especially for the breeders, it's imperative we don't have a split like we see in other gundog breeds with a working strain and the show strain. These are all working dogs, and we should strive to show that off.
And what about temperament? As a hunting dog, the temperament has got to be paramount.
Yeah, I mean, I've found them on the main to be quite calm and collected. He's really good with children. But obviously, I do a lot of work with mine. Yes. They have a lot of exercise, and I'm sure without exercise, they could become quite frustrated and boisterous.
Yeah. And there's not much coat to speak of, but what sort of grooming do they need?
I just go over these, once a day with a rubber grooming mitt. They do shed quite a lot of hair. I have Weimaraners as well, another short-coated breed, and I've found that these definitely lose a lot more hair.
And if someone wants to buy a Bracco as a pet, have you any advice?
I would definitely recommend do your research first. Choose a good breeder. Be prepared to wait for the right puppy for you. They are wonderful dogs and wonderful characters. They can be quite clown-like at times. But I think a Bracco with a job to do is definitely a happy Bracco. They're very intelligent dogs, and I'm sure they'd get frustrated with, lack of boundaries and rules, etc. So general obedience is obviously a must for everybody.
Well, hopefully you feel clued up on the Bracco Italiano, but it's now time to step into the main ring tonight. Best in Show at National Gundog is judged by Frank Kane.
Judged today by Mr. Jeff Roberts. We now have the German short-haired pointer, judged today by Mrs. Fiona Thurm. This is the German short-haired pointer. We now have the German wire-haired pointer, judged today by Mrs. Ruth Martin, and her best of breed is number 266. We now come to the Gordon setter, judged today by Ms. Carol Moore. We now have the Hungarian Wiesler, judged by Mrs. Marion McCangas, and her best of breed is number 368. judged today by Mrs. Christine Schofield. The Hungarian Wirehead Beagle, number 505. Judged today by Mrs. Joyce Whiting. The Irish Red and White Setter, number 523. We now have the Irish Setter. The dogs today were judged by Linda Favrell, and the bitches by Maggie Henderson. We now have the Italian Spinoni, judged today by Mrs. Irene Glenn. We now have the Lagotta Romagnola, judged today by Mrs. Janet Morris. We now have the Large Munsterlander, judged today by Mrs. Pat McCutcheon, and she came up with the winner number 850. Judged today by Mrs. Norma Ellis, the pointer number 893. Judged today by Mrs. Jinty Jill Davis, the Chesapeake Bay Retriever, number 990. We now have the curly-coated retriever, judged by Mr. Colin Mackay, and his best of breed is 1031. The flat-coated retriever. We now come to the golden retriever. The dogs were judged by Mrs. Honor Talbot, and the bitches by Mr. Alan Curry. We now have the Labrador Retriever. Dogs were judged by Mrs. Lorna Blackie, and bitches by Mr. Robert Floyd. We now have the Nova Scotia Duck Tolling Retriever, judged today by Mrs. Carol Cood, and her best of breed was number 1742. We now have the American Cocker, judged today by Mrs. C.M. Bett. The American Cocker Spaniel. The Cocker Spaniel, best of breed today. The dogs were judged by Miss Sarah Amos-Jones, and the bitches by Mr. David Shields. We now have the Clumber Spaniel, judged today by Mrs. Maureen Taylor. The Clumber Spaniel, we're now having the English Springer Spaniel, judged today by Mrs. Jane Eyington, and her best of breed was number 2084. We're now going to the Field Spaniel, judged by Mrs. Carol Gill. We now come to the Irish Water Spaniel, judged today by Mr. Anthony Allen, number 2166. The Sussex Spaniel, judged today by Mr. Bill Bunce, and his best of breed was number 2187. We now have the Welsh Springer Spaniel, judged today by Mrs. Sandra Bell. The Welsh Springer Spaniel. We now have the Spanish Water Dog, judged by Mr. Nigel Eggington. The Spanish Water Dog. Now we come to the Weimaraner, judged today by Mrs. Joan Howarth. The Weimaraner, number 2362.
So we covered off the Italians before Best in Show. Our next breed in the spotlight is a Spaniard. So come back after the break at the home of today's breed judge and Valentissimo Spanish Water Dogs.
Well, Nigel, how on earth did you get involved in a breed that at the time must have been incredibly rare?
Well, many years ago now, about 16 years ago, I lost my golden retriever that used to go everywhere with me to work. It was like my best friend. And I was never going to have another dog. And then as the months went by, I was starting to miss my dog. But what I didn't want was the hares, what came with the golden retriever, yeah. Bruno. So I started looking for a dog that didn't shed, which led me to the Portuguese water dog and then to the Spanish water dog, which when I read about its characteristics, just ticked every box that I wanted it to. Funnily enough, we got two at first, which was a big mistake.
It's a little self-explanatory, but where's the breed from and what was it utilised for?
Well, obviously the breed's from Spain. It's more prominent in the south of Spain, in Andalusia, where it was used like a general farm dog. They would hunt rabbits, they would retrieve game. They do herd, but it's more of a chase, more of a prey drive. Mm. They used it by the fishermen in the ports for recovering fish that had fallen out of the nets and also for taking the ropes off the boats, climbing up the harbour walls, giving them to the fishermen's friends to tie the boats up. And then they were used for guarding the fish.
Incredible. It's a bit of a utility breed.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I've seen them in Spain working with builders. They could be calling them to take tools up onto the roofs, and they used to climb up the ladders onto the roofs. They've just got such a desire to retrieve. And in the water, that retrieve changed into a diving, and they dive like a corkscrew. And I've actually seen them dive up to 6 metres deep.
Wow.
They was actually recognised as an official breed in 1982.
So even, not very long ago at all?
No, even though there's a very old breed and used as a working dog.
And these magnificent coats, what sort of grooming is required on that?
No grooming whatsoever. It's a distinctive woolly coat that makes cords, or cords sometimes is the wrong word. They're fine ringlets. It's a wool coat that grows a centimetre a month and should be clipped off completely at least once a year. So if you want a longer coat, you can let it grow long. And all you do is part the cords with your fingers to split them. It is harder for them to dive if they have a heavy coat on, because it acts as a bit of a buoyancy aid, so water gets underneath. And actually, it's waterproof as well, so the undercoat shields them from our cold weather, so it's like a wetsuit, basically. The secret with the Spanish water dogs is that the Spanish feel very strongly about this. It's a very rustic working breed, and they don't want it altered and shaped by scissoring and stuff like that. It has to be shown in a clean state, but no aesthetic grooming whatsoever, apart from that one clip.
And is there a particular time that you do that?
No, traditionally, it was done in the springtime in Spain, but I mean, you can keep them quite short if you're working. So I clip Baloo twice a year. Paco, if he's got a good coat, would be once a year. Castro, I used to cut once a year. I know my show dogs.
And Castro, one top gun dog a couple of years ago. But one thing was always clear, mischief, and he was full of fun.
That's the breed. That's what the breed is all about. Fun, happiness, not scared of anything, wanting to say hello, coming to see people, be friendly. They shouldn't be nervous, they shouldn't be scared, they should be happy and confident and bold. A working dog that is steady and full of confidence.
Give us a brief overview. What is it the standard asks for?
Basically, you're wanting a dog of no bigger than 50 centimetres, a little bit longer than it is high, a nice strong head, a strong muzzle, pigmentation to match the darkest colour of the dog's coat, a lovely straight front, moderately angled, strong top line, short, strong loin, well-muscled, a tail that's moderately set. The new standard, what the Spanish want to do, is saying it can be carried like a sabre, but not curled over and touching the back, if that gets passed by the FCI. And again, moderately angled in the back. Just a strong working dog.
What are they like as companions? You've got Paco here, retired, next to you.
Oh, Paco, he doesn't think he's retired really, but he has retired now. They're a dog that, if you ask them to do something, will do it and will walk all day long, retrieve all day long. But if they come in the house, they switch off. But more importantly, it's mental stimulation. I mean, we're always working with them, hiding balls. They love praise. They have to know what they've done wrong. They're just such a loyal, devoted breed. Basically, you've got to go and find the breeders, go and visit the dogs, be happy with the parents' characters. You want a KC registered dog, so then your options aren't limited. If you want to go and do flyball, agility, gun dog work, we just need some knowledgeable gun dog people to come and take them on and show all these cockers and springers just what the Spanish are capable of.
Mr. Kane will now have another look around before he no doubt decide to shortlist. The Irish Water Spaniel, Gordon Setter, Lad Munster Lander, the Pointer, the German Shorthaired Pointer, Flat Coated Retriever, and the Brittany, the Labrador, the American Cocker, and the Cocker Spaniel. Weimarana, Irish Water Spaniel, Northern Racco, the Pointer, the Labrador, the American Cocker. Please give the remainder a big hand. Marana having a final run out. Followed by the Irish Water Spaniel. The Bracco Italiano. The Pointer. The Labrador Retriever. And finally, the American Cocker Spaniel. You're now calling for the board's season. Made its decision. Group one is the Pointer. Group two is the Bracco Italiano. Group three, the Labrador. And the Irish Water Spaniel, group four.
Well, Sam, we just can't help but speak to you every show, it seems.
I know, it's amazing. I really can't believe it, actually, today. I just, you know, it's a big gundog show. It's just the one to win at. So.
But she's had success at gundog shows before, hasn't she?
Yeah, she was best in show at Gundog Society of Wales, so to do it here as well is amazing. Go home and celebrate tonight.
And a rather nice wedding present?
Yeah, well, yeah.
What is it Juicy's done up until now? Because she's had an incredible career.
Yeah, she's amazing. She's she broke the breed record, which held for a long time, which is an achievement in itself. And she's gone on to win, you know, 37 now. So she's just amazing. She just carries on, you know, continuing every show. She just shows better and better and better. So.
And how many group wins is that now?
I think that's nine. So yeah, I think.
She's had such an amazing career. What's in the future? Is she going to become a mummy anytime?
She needs to come out for litter now. She's been shown a lot over the past sort of 3 years. She's been campaigned a lot. So, yeah, she'll come out now. She's got nothing to prove. So she can come out and maybe see her next year.
Yeah. Well, that's incredible. Congratulations again. We'll no doubt see you in the future.
Lovely.
Well done.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So, Best in Show and Best Puppy in Show judge tonight at National Gundog, and in fact, Best Veteran in Show yesterday at Houndshow was Frank Kane.
That's right.
Your Best in Show winner tonight, Pointer, Juicy, what did you think of her?
Well, she was in very good form. She was a good winner tonight, I thought. She's got beautiful type, great movement, and I thought she was very worthy today, yes.
And have you seen her before?
I have. She's won a Best of Breed under me before, so obviously I did know her. But today is another day, and I have to look right and go right on the day.
And two very, very good movers are the Best in Show and Reserve, the Bracco in second.
Yes, marvellous mover, and both of them are holding their shape, which is very important, holding their correct shape for the breeds.
And what about your gundog group as a whole? What did you make of the...
Some disappointments, both in type and movement. But the last cut were all very nice. You know, it boils down to breed type and the ones that are going on the day. Yeah. So plenty of good ones at the top.
And you like to make big cuts, don't you?
Well, in a ring like this, in a big group, I think they're worthy, then they know that they're in the running.
And then we move on to Best Puppy, the German short-haired pointer.
Beautiful, beautiful. Absolutely unexaggerated, a great mover. There are no frills breed, and he had everything. Great conformation, correct breed type, good coat, and immaculate mover. So he was good value. And a beautiful cocker puppy in reserve. Very cockery, full of quality.
And we'll very quickly nip back to yesterday, the Hound Best Veteran. You've got a bit of a relationship with the dog or the kennel, at least.
Really? Well, I've judged Petit Bassets in several countries. That dog has won under me in, I think it may have been Finland or Sweden or Scandinavia anyway. And I've not seen him for a lot of years, yeah. And he still looks a wonderful dog.
And we didn't realise until we'd sort of looked in the catalogue afterwards, but I believe the sire of Jilly, the Cross Best in Show winner.
Yes, and also my Best in Show winner from Paignton. So it's a matter of liking the type and liking the family. And if you have a you know, an idea in your mind of what is correct type for the breed, then those dogs are going to appeal to you.
And your weekend has been a busy one, and you've enjoyed yourself?
Very busy, of course. I wouldn't do it if I didn't enjoy it.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us, Frank.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And we'll see you next time on Around the Dog World at City of Birmingham in September.